in England, these disasters show us something, and that is that thousands of people around the world in all walks of life come together and work collectively to provide the much needed emergency support of housing, food, and supplies in our communities after these disasters. But in Plan C, in the assemblies that we've been running across the country over the last month or so, we've started to discuss that we don't want to wait for the next big disaster to experience that moment of people pulling together to get shit done that needs to get done. We want to build the strength in our communities right now. And we want to care for those who've been hit the hardest by a decade of austerity and privatization. And we want to get ready for what's coming next. So it's super amazing to have so many people on this call already. And as Nadia has helpfully pointed out, there is this chat button, which means that during the presentation, you'll be able to add your questions. If you're phoning in, because this is an incredibly sophisticated platform where you can phone in as well, probably the easiest way to get questions to us is via Twitter. And if all of those methods fail, including the courier pigeons that our tech wizards will be sending the questions to me via, you can also email us as well, which is an old form of communication that still works in today's day and age. So you can email, you can contact us on Facebook, on Twitter, courier pigeon, or in the chat box via the Zoom call. We're going to keep everyone muted because there's so many of us on the call, and otherwise you'll be able to hear my children yelling in the background shortly when their attention span runs out from the telly. But without further ado, I'd like to introduce Scott Crowe to you all this evening. Scott Crowe is an anarchist and a speaker and an author and a media spokesperson who proudly comes from a working class background. He spent his varied life as a musician, a co-op business owner, a political organizer, and a green collar worker. The FBI spied on him for over a decade for alleged domestic terrorist threat, for political activities. And he's sometimes been called a jackass, but he thinks of those words as fond recollections of a noble animal. He is the author of a number of books, which lots of people here have probably read or heard of, including Black Flags and Windmills, Setting Sights, Histories and Reflections on Community Armed Self-Defense, and Emergency Hearts and Molotov Dreams. He can be found virtually at scottcrowe.org, and I'm very happy to hand over to him, and he's going to give us a short presentation on mutual aid. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thanks for everybody for joining too. This is these things are always so difficult because I love to see people in person and talk to them and everything. But thank you for everybody taking the time to do this. I want to talk about really quickly before I talk about mutual aid. Has the volume coming through okay? Give me a thumbs up. Yeah? Everybody good? Okay. So I want to talk about disasters in a broader sense right now, because you are obviously in the middle of a disaster. We're all in a long, slower disasters that are happening right now. But disasters are beyond just being ecological, which is the main form that we think about it. They take forms in economics. They take forms in political and also in war. I consider all of these forms of disasters that we should approach in thinking about any of the mutual aid that we want to engage in. And so Brexit and actually the current state of politics in your country is a disaster from me in Texas, what it looks like here. You know, it looks pretty bad. So that said, I mean, we have a buffoon, you know, I don't, but other people have a buffoon for the president. To me, he's just a television personality buffoon that is still on. Now he's the president television buffoon. So if there's disasters happening and we know that they can take all kinds of forms, that doesn't mean that everything falls apart overnight. And that's a problem for a lot of us, because then we begin to forget about it. Climate change is one of the biggest disasters, and disasters happen in fits and starts. Sometimes they affect localized areas very much, but other times they mostly happen in waves where something cataclysmic can happen, but at the same time, slow things are happening to other people, like austerity. We don't call it that in the United States, but it's the same thing. I mean, people are being squeezed to death under all of these things. Neoliberalism has brought that to our door. So I think that in thinking about that, if that's the first step, then the second thing is, if we can't rely on governments, right? can't vote our way out of this. We haven't been able to vote our way out of it for however long we've been doing electoral politics in all of our countries. And then we also realize that corporations aren't going to save us, right? You can't buy your way out of this. There's not the greenest product is not going to deal with immigration. You're never going to fix these things with economics in those ways. And then the third way that we largely deal with stuff is activism. We often, like we say, we'll do this protest, we'll do this letter writing campaign and stuff. And so what I would say is that those three modes of engagement all have cost benefit ratios to them. I wouldn't say that don't vote at all. I don't vote. I you know, I'm an anarchist. But for those who do vote for things, well, that's the least we could do. The same with activism. It's the least we can do. Or buying your way out of something, it's the least we can do. But what I'm really actually trying to propose is this idea of liberatory mutual aid, where we begin to build what anarchists have called autonomy for a long time and different forms of communism. We don't have to split all the political language of it. But what I want to do is build a liberatory consciousness around thinking about how do we take control of our own lives as individuals, as neighbors in our neighborhood, as in larger communities, whatever community means to you, and that we begin to build autonomous and networked communities and overlapping groups that can deal with these disasters and very, oh my goodness, did I just lose everything? Did I lose everybody? Can y'all still hear me? I don't hear anybody. I'm looking at Twitter now. I see you, Camille. I don't see anybody else. And I don't hear anything.
We can still hear you.
You can. Okay, yeah. Thank you. Sorry about that. Now you're back. I don't know what happened. I got muted. Okay, so what I would challenge all of us to do is to begin to ask ourselves the very difficult questions of how do we organize differently and think differently about the way that we organize with a liberatory approach to mutual aid. And what is mutual aid? Mutual aid at its root is just cooperation. It's just cooperation. There's no specialty to it. It's just a different way to say it. And we do better when we all cooperate. Individually, we do better about certain things. We do better in hierarchies in certain ways. But really, generally, when people cooperate, we can do better. But in that, in the liberatory approach, is recognizing that governments are always going to fail us at the individual level, at a neighborhood level, at larger community levels. They're always going to fail because they're always going to, in the face of disasters, give uneven approaches to dealing with that, and there's always bureaucracy behind it. So I know I'm covering a lot of topics because I got 10 minutes to do this, but this is all in trying to get a liberatory approach towards mutual aid. And we begin to ask ourselves, how do we organize it not in traditional activist ways, but through liberatory approaches? And that might mean reaching out across the aisle to people that you're not comfortable with, but have that have mutual interest in trying to protect themselves also. Now, I'm not saying that we have to make friends with everybody and be all hunky-dory. I don't even care about that. I'm an anarchist because I like being siloed in many, many ways. But when we do this, it opens up a way that when the disaster strikes our community, our neighborhood, our regional area, or our country, that we have the nimbleness to be able to deal with it in a very forceful manner, and we have the resources to do it, time, money, and people, and we have the authority to do it ourselves because we have given ourselves the authority to do it. So these are liberatory approaches towards mutual aid that I hope that people want to get towards. And I saw it in England and France and stuff when people were dealing with the immigration, the true immigration problems that y'all were having when people were refugees were trying to come in because they were being killed. And so when people were taking boats out, when people were saying, we will go against what the law says or what the state says or those in power says to help these people because their lives are wrapped in mine, that begins towards the ideas of liberatory mutual aid. And also within that is the idea of solidarity and not charity. charity is a problem. It's a huge problem in the nonprofit industrial complex. It's a huge problem in our lives because we confuse it with solidarity. Solidarity says, basically, at its root of ideas, that we are all in this together. Even if I have more access to resources, whatever that is, privilege or money or time or people, but you don't have those, but your struggle is still tied to mine. We are still interconnected. That is super important. That's solidarity. I'm not helping you because I want to feel better about myself or just because I want to, we all need to pat ourselves on the back or fix a Band-Aid, but it says because it's necessary for me to do that. It is important for me to do that because it makes all of our lives better. And I believe that at my core, whereas charity is about power over. Charity is all about, I've got these resources, you need resources, I'm just gonna help you, but I'm gonna maintain the power, the authority, everything that's behind it without having to really engage in it. Now, sometimes these things get confused because there's the need is so great, right? I know you've seen it with homelessness, you've seen it with immigration. There's things that services that need to be provided to people that are very important. But, and so sometimes it's the approach to how you approach it is as important as how you engage in it. And even in the work that we had done at Common Ground, which I'll talk about in a minute, it's like some of it was just charity service work, but we approached it from a solidarity aspect, recognizing that there was incredible limits to what we were doing. And there were other times we did it, we approached it with a very liberatory analysis, and it was absolutely solidarity. And I'll give examples of that a little bit later. So I'm gonna keep moving on real quick and show how some of this kind of examples of where this has happened. So in the United States, and I actually think it's happening worldwide or we wouldn't be having these conversations, is that people are recognizing that disasters are becoming more common. Climate change, the political instability, the rise of fascism and right-wing nations, the forcing of people to immigrate in large numbers again because of either ecological or economic or political disasters in their countries, and war, right? So, and the way that it's beginning to manifest itself is that, and it has been since 2005 that I've seen in the United States, is where people are beginning to organize themselves to respond right after the disaster. Again, in the UK, I saw a lot after the refugees problem. It's 2 years ago, 3 years ago. Now, I'm sorry, I can't remember the exact timeline, but everybody understands what I'm talking about, remembers. You guys had a real refugee crisis. We don't have a refugee crisis. We're creating one. I live 2 hours from where the tiny-handed orange one is creating a refugee crisis every day. So in that, the way after Hurricane Katrina came, the largest natural disaster in the United States, we say natural, but climate change, political and economic factors were all in what made it a disaster within a disaster, is that we approached it from an anarchist point of view that combined two things, really, three things, actually. I looked to the Zapatistas and what they had done in creating autonomy and mutual aid within their communities under their own disasters for 20 years at that point, which was to create land-based, autonomous and accountable communities to each other where they truly shared power or worked to share power. The other thing I looked to a lot was the Black Panther Party here in the United States, not because the Maoism and the hierarchies and stuff, but this one concept they had, which was survival programs pending revolution. And it is solidarity, not charity, because basically they were saying, the Black Panthers in the 60s were saying that communities can't get a leg up because they've got to meet their basic needs, healthcare, education, food. These are the basics of civil society. These are the things that keep us going. It's not work. It's not, there's other things like creativity and stuff. I'm sure we could, that's a bigger, larger conversation, but at the root, food, healthcare, education, shelter. That's all we need. So they said that if people can meet their basic needs, then they can move from that to be able to build a liberatory analysis, to be able to take care of themselves, to be able to, for them, foment revolution, whatever that looked like. So that's what I'm saying with that. And then the third piece was anarchy, which is to bring the ideas of mutual aid, the ideas of autonomy, to bring the ideas of direct action, that we will not wait on governments. We will not wait on corporations, nonprofits, other groups to tell us how to do it. If we see a need, we will take action to make it happen, not just to fight in the streets or just to stop some corporation, but to begin to build education, healthcare, all of these things from the ground up in localized communities with those communities in liberatory mutual aid. And so that's kind of where Common Ground came from. And so we started with three people. And as the story goes, lots of things happened. The police hated us, tried to murder us. The white militias tried to murder us. And then we began to get more people coming. And so 36,000 people came. Three people started it, and 36,000 people came over the next 3 years. People just like yourself, who had this thing inside of them called what I call their emergency heart, which pumps with this thing to do, to the desire to make things happen, to say, I see a need that needs to be filled that isn't going to be just charity, that I'm willing to throw myself at it. It's a passionate and it's a beautiful thing. And so people like yourselves began to come. So now that those ideas are established, we see what happened at Occupy, the Occupy movements. So after Common Ground, we didn't just come in and say, we're going to do one thing. We said, we're going to redo everything at Common Ground. So an example is education. We approached it two ways. We used dual power, which is to resist on one hand, but to create on the other. And so what we did was we created liberatory free schools because all the schools were closed down, but we also used direct action to force some of the schools to open. Like there's a school called the Martin Luther King School. We broke into the school and with the students who had come back, cleaned out the school so they could reopen the school. So while that was happening in this beautiful way, this other thing was happening for the kids who couldn't go to that school, where people in communities were building impromptu educational facilities for people so kids could go to school. This is a year and 2 years after the storm. So that's an approach. The other approach is that instead of just trying to fix somebody's immediate medical needs, we said, could we build a first aid station based on street medics? Could street medics get doctors to come and we could build a clinic? Could a clinic become a hospital? We began to dream big, not for ourselves, like we're going to create one entity and it's going to be gone. This entity is just part of all of these. So while we're thinking about this one first aid station becoming a clinic, we built seven more clinics, and some of them were mobile. That said, all of them were liberatory, so they weren't going to exist. They weren't becoming permanent institutions. So it began that years later, two of them existed, and now just one exists, because of lack of resources, time, money, and people, and then moving on things. But so again, these are liberatory approaches to mutual aid that didn't involve governments. You didn't see me talk about protesting to get something and asking somebody for something. You didn't see me demanding something from somebody. You saw us saying, we will do this ourselves. Because as I've said many times, at the end of the day, it's just us. I mean, there's no government's gonna save us. You know this, or we wouldn't be having these conversations. There is no corporation who's gonna step in and be benevolent. It is just us and the people around you who are gonna make these things happen. And so getting to know us and working together on this and building these visions are where we need to start. I can't hear anybody, so.
That's okay, you can hear me because I have hosting power and can unmute myself. Thank you so much for that. We had a question, I think, that was probably directly related to the Common Ground examples that you were just giving. Yes. from Nadia, which was around building healthcare mm-hmm. and health infrastructure, and how you build ground up health when there's obviously questions around levels of skill needed around doing health work.
Oh my gosh, messily, very messy. That's how you build it. but you start with the premise of a liberatory idea. I want to do this. This is a necessary thing to happen. And then you begin to do it. And so there's going to be all different levels, because even street medics, you'll have street medics there, right? Right. Okay. So street medics, they have networks here. And so there's different levels of skill. Some of them only have CPR training. Some of them are doctors. Some of them are nurses. Some of them are mountain wilderness EMTs. And so you just begin to see what is needed in your disaster or your crisis, and you begin to call for those people to come. The other thing is that once you try to make these things permanent or institutional, you're going to lose some of the liberatory aspect because you are going to fall into regulation unless you say, fuck it, I'm going to do this anyway. And that's a whole different set. You know, that was in New Orleans, that was an issue. Of the two permanent clinics, one of them went completely the regulatory route. That's the one that still exists, still does good work. It's more charitable than it is solidarity. And then the second one that was long-term existing to said they wouldn't do that. They made it permanent. They did all of these things, but they didn't want to jump through all the hoops about prescriptions and taking insurance and all these things. And so they weren't able to make it continue. Now, why each of those pieces happened, I can't tell you because I wasn't at the meetings for that stuff, but that's the way you approach it. You know, like, I don't know if we need permanent buildings for everything. If you just built mobile clinics that were in vans, like you see at charity things, but they went to disasters or went into areas of great need, what does that look like? The thing is, I am approaching this conversation or even this talk with more questions than I have answers. I just have some experiences and mistakes along the way. And if I could step back for a second just to say, I didn't just start thinking about this after Katrina. I was in DC on September 11th, 2001, when the planes hit the buildings. And so I watched power completely fall. And that was the first time. I wasn't the only one. The few of us that were there, we were like, hey, what is this? Like, what could we do? And I realized that in activism and the activist subculture I'd been in for 20 years, that we didn't have the tools to deal with it. All we had was the oppositional tools to demand things from people, but we didn't have very many tools to ask ourselves, what is it we want and how do we want to get there and how do we keep our communities safe for ourselves? I can't hear you.
Sorry. I keep forgetting about the whole muting thing. So we've got quite a few questions coming in, but maybe one thing that someone was asking on Twitter was around maybe fleshing out a little bit for us this kind of a little bit more around how we make sure that our work doesn't become depoliticized. So I think quite a lot of people on this call have like a very sympathetic to the idea around mutual aid and around solidarity. But in these thinking about it in when we've expanded out mm-hmm. the idea of disaster sure. away from the kind of immediate ways in which many of us probably understand disaster, which is usually ecological or in very rare instances where people get some planes and fly them into some really big buildings.
Right.
But we weren't going to talk about 9/11 and you brought it up. And so
wait for the truthers. Where are they?
No, it's, we're not in America. There's only a very small amount of them in the UK. So maybe thinking okay. about this question, like as we've kind of extended out this question around disaster and we've made disaster sure. a bit bigger.
The Zapatistas call it a crack in history. When we open these liberatory moments, they call it a crack in history. And the question to what you're asking is that how do we maintain that is a question I don't have the answers to. I have some ideas around it because we haven't, in most of the projects I've ever been part of, or the ones I know about, they didn't maintain it because they became either much more traditional, much more conservative in some ways, or they just ceased to exist. So one, I would think, is making sure that every step of the way that you continue to approach it with a liberatory analysis. And the liberatory analysis would be, what creates autonomy? Where's mutual aid fit in this? How do we take direct action on this? And the other thing I would think about is not to be afraid of getting money. We live in a total capitalist system. And one of the things that we often feel like is that we can only have fundraisers where we raise $800 on beer, or we go into the nonprofit world and that's the only thing, those are the only choices we do. I would say there's other ways that are, and I don't want to talk about markets so much because this is a thing, but there's black and gray markets. There's things outside of the mainstream capitalist systems that are not challenging the power, but you can use to take the cost benefits better to take the money from that to build what you need to do. We need money. The other piece is to think about resources that you always need, time, money, and people, and don't burn them down because we have a tendency to do that. The other piece in creating a liberatory analysis or approach to these is to not fall in the pitfalls of activism and begin to go like, well, they've already done this for a long time. Maybe we should do that again. I would challenge that because we have these well-worn ways that are become easier for us to fall into. This happens with co-ops of all kinds. This happens with every liberatory institution that is built. So the question is, how do we build liberatory institutions that don't fall victim to that, to the issues of capital and entropy and all these things? And I don't know if there's an answer, but I do know that every organization doesn't have to exist for a long time. It's okay if they go away, especially if they feel the need at that point. If they can be liberatory and reinvent themselves over and over again, then I think that's okay. And the only place I can even point to that, because I'm an ignorant person, but this is what I know about the Zapatistas. They have continued to challenge. They've come with a liberatory approach. They don't call it that. And said, what are we doing? Does it make sense? Will it move us forward? And does it cover enough of us? These are questions they ask again and again, and they revisit it. And when it doesn't, you know what they say? Well, we can't close that down because we'll lose funding. They say, let's just stop it because it doesn't work. It's not working. So we would never do that. We invest in a building, just pretend that happened, and or whatever it is. We must do everything to maintain that organization or those jobs or anything. That's not true. Because unless you don't pretend it's liberatory, you say, it's just my job to do that. So beyond those broad ideas, I don't have specifics about things because this is something I've been exploring in a book for a long time.
Okay, I've reclaimed my...
Hi!
Hi, sorry, I'm back. We had a question from someone who's been doing a lot of work in our assembly, in our mutual aid working group, and that was, did you think that this stuff works best in small groups of people, just starting to get things done, or do, like, at what critical mass could we start to think? Obviously, there's different cities in the UK. Often we think of London,
sure.
Only yeah. One, which has 9 million fuckers.
I'm with you. I think it's small groups, but I think challenging ourselves and those around us to begin to take liberatory approaches, to like very conscious liberatory approaches, not like Alessio had mentioned earlier, where you have the name solidarity, not charity, but you're really just a service industry. Don't just take the slogans, but how do you approach it from a liberatory stance? If we begin to build foundations based on some broader liberatory ideas, mutual aid, direct action, autonomy. These are things that can be reinterpreted everywhere. And one of the things I like to say is that start in small groups because you want to find people that you can get along with in this as you build it because you're creating a culture. And the culture is as important as the politics because in the culture that you create, as you expand, will also be challenged within that. And so you want to see, is this the culture we want to move forward? The way I like to look at it is like, the liberatory foundation, the ideas are basically like a forest. A forest anywhere is made of the same kind of components, right? You say trees and flora and fauna of varying kinds. And from outer space, they might look even the same. But as you get closer, a forest in England looks far different than a forest in Arizona in the United States or in Texas. But they have the similar elements to them. So is there a liberatory approach where we have similar ideas, not based in parties, not based in being the most moralistic and the most correct people, and also liberatory approaches to, I'm willing to say this is not working and ask myself questions about it and what can we do about that? The last piece I would say in that, in these foundations, is that not to sell ourselves short, go for everything. All we have to give up is our lives. That's really it. That's a lot. I'm not saying that everybody has to go kill themselves or do anything, but we're all going to get there. So we may be able to stay away from the disaster. Can y'all still hear me? Okay. So we may be able to stay away from disasters. They may affect people farther away. But like in my life, they've become more and more common, and I'm not rushing towards them. I'm an accidental warrior. I want to tell you that. I'm not somebody who runs into this, but I have hurricane season, which is within 2 hours of me, and I have fire season, which is around me, and tornado season, all converge in this area, just in ecological disasters. That didn't even count about what's happening in Texas economically. You guys have Boris Johnson. He's just one. We have a whole clown car army that runs this state. So if that helps.
I know. I need to unmute myself. I'm getting better at this transition.
I like it.
Yeah.
And the thing is, if I'm talking too long, pull me back, because I want to make sure that we're getting to the information that people want out of this. I don't need to just pontificate. So.
You're doing great. So there was a question here from someone in Bristol, which was, could you talk a bit about what happens to people in terms of getting them involved in terms of consciousness raising? And that's something that we've played around a lot with in Plan C in a whole variety of different ways, both from a feminist point of view. And I don't know if you've seen a lot about people's latest work, which is around acid communism. And thinking through different ideas around consciousness raising, and they've been doing really big parties and big meetings around consciousness raising. So this is an idea that's kind of been circulating within the organization for a long time. But in your work and in in terms of the projects, what role does consciousness raising play in building mutual aid?
Well, it's an important role in anything, right? We should always be consciousness raising about everything. But what the problem is that I don't think it's lack of information that it is. So I've been doing politics for 35, 37 years now. And what I keep seeing is that we have waves of people who get energized and learn new information about stuff. This is especially pre-internet, where people could get, learn, like you really have to learn about it. I think that that's really important. But what happens is that if they leave movements, if they leave projects, if they just leave, but they take that nothing with, we start over again. So consciousness raising for me would be not just the first step of we all do that, but how do you maintain that level of consciousness raising in a liberatory approach as you keep going 5 years from now, 8 years from now, where those people who stayed in got consciousness raising at a period of time and think that they know it all now, but really there's new stuff to learn because there's new consciousness raising going on, to me would be the next steps of that. This is one thing that I disagree with, not about consciousness raising, because that's important, but activists in general about, is that we need to show people and tell people these things because they don't know what's happening. Bull fucking shit. Everywhere I go, everybody knows shit is bad. They may not exactly know what it is, but they know that shit is bad, and that many people, especially those with the boot on the neck, they may not be able to name it exactly, but they know shit's bad. So what I would propose in consciousness raising is long-term stuff, but also solutions, not the answer, but guideposts towards how do you consciousness raise towards people start moving towards doing things to make their own lives better for themselves and for each other. And that's not an abstract, and I'm not trying to make people feel good about it. And I'm also not challenging people and saying, don't fucking do consciousness raising. Of course, man, we've got to raise consciousness, but don't raise it for just the problems. We all know shit's bad. Raise it for I said solutions, but that's not it, because I don't have the answers what the solution is, but towards the possibilities. I mean, God, I mean, really, if I can cut it, let's move towards a politics of possibilities, the politics and engagements of possibilities. And that's the kind of consciousness raising we need, because we are not just me, and this is not just anecdotal, we are our own worst enemies. We are our own worst enemies. So let's just stop doing it, and let's raise consciousness towards possibilities and for the long term, not just in the immediate about Brexit or whatever the crisis is in front of us, the disaster, but for a longer term and revisit. Because when you do that, again, you're like the Zapatistas, you're approaching it again. You're like, look, we were doing these things. We thought they were liberatory, saw the shortcomings of those. Let's don't do that again. What is it that we can do? Does that make sense? It's a totally different approach. It's a different approach.
Yeah, and I think it relates to one of the questions that someone's posted here, which is that The Tories or the conservative fuckers that run our country here have specifically referenced food banks as a positive thing. So they've taken starving people and the creation of charity-based food banks, and they've said it's a great thing in that austerity here is a large part of it is now based on the third sector, the charity sector, organizations taking up the slack from the shrinking state. So I think, and I've encountered this when I've taken a lot of these ideas out outside of the radical left into the more kind of social democratic left. How do we stop, and this is what people say, is how do we stop our community organizing just simply helping the further imposition of austerity, like and allowing the state to further and further shrink away, which here is very much the main game in town.
I think that really, again, I don't have the answer, but I think if you approach it with a liberatory analysis, that won't happen. If you are like, is this working? Are we just filling the need, or are we creating, are we helping these people to create liberation for themselves? Now, there's some things that I think that we have to, this is the nihilist part of myself that I have to be honest about. There's some things that just cannot be fixed. Like there's just like homeless people dealing at this stage, dealing with alcohol, drug problems, and mental health is such, just in that one thing, just this one thing is such a large thing that we are not going to solve that problem. We have tried our like multiple times, multiple groups have, you know, tried to, there's some amount of service that's just going to happen. Now, out of that, if you're just providing basic service for somebody, what I would ask myself is there a liberatory approach to this that's not about asking for more nonprofit money, not just about maintaining the status quo in it, but also that could be liberatory towards helping other people in that? Like saying that we are going to occupy these buildings because these buildings are empty and now we're going to take them back over for housing. It may not help that particular group that's just getting the service, but there's other people who are tangentially related to that who want housing, who can deal with that. That's a liberatory dual power approach to it. Does that make sense? So and I'll give you a more concrete example. We approach abortion that way in Texas, and because it's almost illegal in the United States. It's getting, in Texas, there was 44 clinics. There's two now. So, and those clinics don't just provide abortions, they also provide women's health services. So the minimal approach is to just to go to a large nonprofit like Planned Parenthood and give them money and try to make things better, or to say, you know, like we'll make sure that women have health services through these charity organizations, which are religious now in the States, if anybody's paying attention. And, but to challenge that and go to women who are giving abortions, planning for abortions, or providing the actual stuff that is illegal for abortions, taking direct action. And so that's an approach that many people are taking here. And so that's a dual power thing. You've got some women who just need the service, but there's other people who are like, I've taken on this service and we're building this thing. Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, it certainly does. And it's definitely relevant in the Republic of Ireland, who recently won a really important vote. But what activists, feminists there, who I'm in communication with, have said is that, of course, the rollout of that law is just lagging, right? Like that the actual provision on the ground just isn't actually, like it amazingly, Ireland hasn't turned into a mecca for reproductive freedoms overnight just because some feminists won a referendum.
Right.
And so I think a lot of these ideas are really relevant in terms of even when we do make policy or when we make gains at the level of the state, how we can actually make them real in our lives as opposed to just simply waiting for the government to one day finally do what they say they were going to do.
Right.
So there was a new kind of thread that's been suggested in the chat, which was, can you tell us a little bit about experiences of joy and love and care when engaged?
Oh my gosh, yes.
Questions of mutual aid.
That's the beauty of it, is that mutual aid is about, and liberatory mutual aid specifically, is about the idea that I care about you because you're worth caring about, because the planet's worth caring about, because the other non-human animals are worth caring about on the planet. And that at root gives me joy. I feel it now. And I don't even have to believe that it's all going to work out. But at its root, I mean, I want to approach it with absolute love. And it sounds super trite, but I want to alleviate suffering. You know what? Almost 40 years of doing that. I was like, that's all that's at its root. Like, and mutual aid begins to provide that. And when you begin to work with people and you think about it, not just how much I'm going to get out of this or what I can do with this, man, it opens up a whole other world of people outside of your experiences that you're dealing with, especially when you're treating them with respect and dignity and, you know, following their lead on things or collaborating on their lead. It just opens up possibilities to talk to people outside of our own little spheres. And especially, I would say this, because I've left activist subculture. I know I've said this a lot, but I left activist subculture. I don't do it anymore. I refuse to, because I like hanging out in communities that are beyond mine. I have my safety communities that I see all the time and reinforce values, but then I have other ones that challenge my ideas, and I go talk to those people and I engage with them, not to prove them or to convert them. That's the other thing. Do not convert people. I don't give a shit, man. Don't convert people. That's not our job. You don't know the answer. I don't have the answer. None of us have the fucking answers. We're all in this together. Everything that we do, every mistake that we made, that's a beautiful, joyous thing to me, when taking that weight off and going like, huh, I don't really know. I'm going to set this over here. Tell me about something, because I'm curious about it. That is the joy in mutual aid to me. Some of this.
Yeah, and that sounds amazing, and truly revelationary for those of us who are still stuck in activist world, carrying far too much of that baggage around. I think there was a few questions I missed up here that I just wanted to come back to, which is, I think that people were just wanting to hear a few more thoughts on, we're basically ready to go in a number of different assemblies around mutual aid projects. And I think what people are really trying to get their heads around is, what's the next step? Like we're kind of, there's a whole variety of need that mm-hmm. is really obvious to us in our various communities or in our neighborhoods, mm-hmm. and it takes a degree of a leap of faith to break away from writing a leaflet and going and organizing a demo in the way that all of us probably now feel quite comfortable. And so I think maybe it was a question around, you know, do we start with the kind of, you know, our assemblies in London attract like 80 or 90 people to them, and they were on a weekly basis. In Bristol, similar kinds of numbers, maybe a little bit smaller, and in different parts around the country. So it's not like, there's not kind of four of us sitting there being like, okay, well, who's going to get the soup for the soup kitchen kind of thing. But I think people are maybe just thinking a little bit about, like, do we, around scalability and this question, like, when there's a disaster, it seems somehow contained, right? Like, we can understand the scale of the thing that we're trying to act upon, and then applying these principles of liberatory consciousness and liberatory action, there's a certain boundedness to it. But in terms of, when we are trying to do this in the slow violence of neoliberalism, and there's this real question around scale. And so maybe if you could just talk a bit about scale and kind of intervening into the everyday of the kind of violence of capital.
If we figure that out, somebody should write that book, because that's the book. I mean, that's the thing, is how do you feel this when you don't feel it? How do you move on it when it seems an abstract? Climate change is an abstract. Brexit seems like, because disasters, whatever form they take, will make you move faster than anything. It will change your opinion on ideas, and it will also show you things that you can do about, you know, things that you had a skill set that you never thought you had about yourself. And I'm not talking about like people dying all over the place, but just disasters themselves. And so this idea that you're talking about, how do we do it when we don't feel it? The only thing that I'm willing to say is that you've already got the meetings. Begin to build a liberatory approach to how those things are. And I don't mean activist approach. I'm telling you, there's going to be a lot of challenges taking activism out. Believe me, I'm a heretic in activist world in the United States now. But because I don't want, like, and I won't show up at another meeting. I won't show up at another protest. Until we're building barricades in the streets because it's the real deal, then I'm there. So if you want people to approach stuff, you build an analysis and a framework that is open-ended, just like the Zapatistas did, that people can see themselves into and create possibilities. Don't just say the shit you're against, because we're all against everything. Start to articulate what you're for. And again, the Zapatistas, look at what they tell you. They don't tell you, they're against neoliberalism. Great. They don't like power, capital P power. They want to build people power from below. But what they tell you is that they want to build dreams of the future where their children can do these things, where they can build these things, where they can have this autonomy. They sell dreams to us from that little forest in Chiapas, Mexico, all over the world. That has taken root in people's hearts everywhere. So sell dreams of possibilities. Don't be stuck in politics of reaction and resistance. We are already resisting by doing this, but what is it you want to create, and how do you move people towards that? And a liberatory approach is the only thing that's going to do that. That said, recognize that no party, I don't care no party is going to do it. No organization is going to do it. We're all going to do this together. And we're going to work outside ourselves. We're going to work with people who are not going to carry the political line. We're going to work with people who are not, I'm not saying you have to be friends with everybody, but I work with people who just, they say things incorrectly sometimes because that's the way they're raised. It doesn't necessarily mean they're on the Trump bandwagon. It just means that was the way they're raised. If I can have a conversation with them instead of shunning them, then I've opened the door to somebody who is now an ally at the least and a collaborator at the most. So approaching this, began to set up a formation of ideas of how do we build this dream and how are we going to do it together? What does it look like in Bristol? What does it look like in neighborhoods within Bristol? What does it look like in my neighborhood in Bristol? I mean, break that shit down and go what is it we need? What do people want? Ask people, start asking questions, lead by obeying, ask questions. You know, people are terrified about Brexit. Ask them what they want to do. Not online only. Go out in the streets. Talk to people outside of your communities and ask them, what would help with this? What do you think we could do? And not like a survey or a poll, but begin to build it. Because when we ask, the same here, when we ask, then people have more buy-in on it. You know? And when you guys have the assemblies in London, when you have the assemblies in Bristol, when you have them everywhere, begin to get together and then open them up. But I'm not saying open it up to everybody, because liberatory, I mentioned this earlier and it was a small piece, but remember, you're creating a culture. You're trying to recreate a culture within, and that's super important. You're not just creating a body of politics, you're creating a culture. And those things are fragile. We either make them insular and then, you know, become like the Marxist-Leninist Maoist of the 60s, 70s, and 80s. I mean, I can only speak to those, like where they just became so insular, they became irrelevant. They became really irrelevant. And again, I'm not just kicking on them. I mean, I could say the Green Party has done the same thing in many ways, you know, like, or I could go down a whole bunch of lists of things. But so we begin to create a culture and then keep that culture living and dynamic as new people come in. Give them buy-in to that. Well, can you do that with 500 people? I don't fucking know. Can you do it with 30 people? Hell yes, you can do it. But I can tell you, if you wait until the day of the disaster or the day after the disaster, it makes it a lot harder to do. If you build them now, the force can grow.
Yeah, that's what we, certainly in relation to Brexit, there's the impending doom of Brexit has certainly spurred a lot of these discussions on. And obviously, as the ecological catastrophe unfolds, more and more people are becoming aware of the need for, say, basic things like fucking food.
Exactly.
Yeah. And so I think we've probably got time for one more question before we bring this amazing experiment to the end. We're all doing great.
Okay, good.
There's been a question here, which is, there's been a lot of talk around community responses and community organizing, but very few of us, in particularly in cities like London, inhabit meaningful communities anymore. And if we do, what we actually now inhabit are activist communities or scenes.
Terrible.
how do we go about kind of confronting either do communities pre-exist or are they formed, and which community do we orientate towards?
Okay, community is one of those shorthand leftist organizing words that we use a lot. And it's kind of meaningless because there's multiple communities. And in any square block, there can be multiple overlapping communities. People live in a neighborhood because of economics, because their family moved there, cultural things that, you know, maybe, or religious things. There's ideas that, that people gather around. And I think the lowest common denominator that happens to us often is what they just mentioned, which is that we just get into activist communities, which is this catch-all phrase for everything. I don't like all activists. I don't even actually agree with all activists, but somehow we end up in these communities trying to make decisions together. And I don't think that they're even a representative of the greater world. I think that it's just a default position. So the question is, how do you become part of that? I think is that you begin to look for communities outside of that that have liberatory potential. And liberatory potential is different than politics. Does that make sense? Maybe it's a sewing community, and you really do, like, because you're way into sewing, you get into a sewing community, and you're not going there to convert them into your religion of activism. You're going there because you want to have community with somebody because you have common interests in things and you develop friendships. That's way more important than anything. And then at some point, you'll find out that those people also know shit's bad. And then they may be going, what can we do about it? And then you start to have those conversations like, well, you could vote your way out of it. Hasn't worked. Could buy our way out of it. Probably not going to happen. Or we can just start to go with plan C and figure out what the hell that means. Do you know what I mean? And community is a word that is very tricky. I like to say communities because there are so many overlapping communities. And this is the one of the big community is one of the big problems that in the larger alienation of our current world, that I don't know how everybody can get around it. I know how I get around it, but I don't know if that works for everybody. You know what I mean? I'm in multiple overlapping communities that don't necessarily interact with them with each other even, and I'm okay with that.
Okay.
And I have one more depressing thing to say, if I could, before we wrap it up, and then we'll say something positive.
Definitely.
One question I get a lot, and I was going to see if it was going to happen, is that, do we want to wish this to happen? Is this going to bring about, like, the worst things bring about? No. When bad things happen, the worst elements of people, not necessarily people in this room or these rooms, but the worst elements come out also. And they often come out in larger numbers than we do. And it's not because people are against cooperation at a root level, but wishing for this destruction to come to us, I'm gonna say it in very serious terms, people will die and people are dying. And I just can't wish for that. And also when stuff gets bad, I watch fascism rise a lot. You know, Common Ground in New Orleans was an exception. You know, Occupy was an exception. You know, all the mutual aid disaster things are exceptions there. But hopefully they're gaining ground to become more of the, I don't want to say the rule, but more influence than that. Does that make sense? So, sorry, I didn't mean to bum everybody out at the end.
No, I don't think that's bumming us out at all, actually, because one of the reasons why we want to get prepared for the disaster is so that we can shape the disaster when it comes, right?
Damn right. That's good planning. All right. Recognize that you have no control.
Well, I struggle with that. But anyway, I'm working on my control issues. All right, so we're going to do this really cheesy thing that Charlie Mack said I also had to do. And if he was on this call, I would stop calling him out so much, but he's not. I'm going to unmute everyone, and everyone's going to say thank you to Scott, because you were our first person to come on one of these Zoom calls, and it's fucking amazing. And this has been really awesome. In terms of links to things in the Facebook group, we'll post the links to the Common Ground Collective, to the book that you wrote about it, and also further links where people can go and do some further research. Obviously, we've also been recording tonight, and so we might do a bit of an edit around different stuff and put in some green room kind of special effects. No, I'm joking. It'll be up online tomorrow. Also, we have assemblies coming up in Bristol and also in London, and there's a whole variety of discussions going on, and I think tonight's discussion has probably really taken those forward.
So anyway, I'm going to unmute everyone, and on the count of three, we're all going to say thank you.
Oh my God.
1, 2, 3. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Enjoy that. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Awesome.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good night. Good night. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. This has been fucking amazing. I don't know how to end this call, but I'm going to try to do that to disconnect from you all in a really harsh and full-on way. Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.